Good evening. First of all, I would like to thank the Macedonian Society of Great Britain and especially the President, Ms. Venturi, for the invitation to give this lecture. It is an honor for me, and I really enjoy being among you tonight. I hope at the end the whole presentation meets your expectations. The origin of the Athonite heritage is dating back to the Byzantine Empire. The emperors, the emperors and other influential persons of the empire aided in every possible way the Holy Mountain in order to develop a great architecture which would reflect the glory of the Byzantium. The financial capacity, the geomorphic conditions of the area, and the need for protection from the pirate raids during medieval times resulted in the creation of large building projects based on the principles of Byzantine fortress architecture. So the high walls that surround each monastery, except that they are a real fortress, with turrets, battlements, and defensive towers, at the same time they symbolize the limits of the monastic community from the outside world. The isolation and absence of secular life has obliged each monastery to become as much as possible a self-sufficient production unit. The original form of the Athonite monastery has been therefore a combination of a Byzantine fortress on the outside and a set of urban-type buildings focused on the Catholicon on the inside. The settlement of Mount Athos are classified in the following categories. There are 20 monasteries. Each one is a large fortress-like building complex with its building arranged in a perimeter around the courtyard whose center is occupied by the large church, the Catholicon. In addition to the ruling monasteries, there are many other smaller settlements. There are 12 skites. The four cenobitic skites set up just like the monasteries, that is, as a closure of monasteries. They are smaller, poorer, and more ascetic compared to their parent house, but their organization is very similar to that of monasteries. The eight idiorhythmic skites are more loosely structured, having the form of a cluster settlement of houses known as calives, which are scattered around the main common church, the so-called Kyriakon. Cells or kelia represent the smallest organized monastic establishments. They are independent buildings scattered around the cliffs and valleys of the mountain. They have living quarters and an attached chapel. They are generally occupied either by a single monk or by a small group of monks. Calives and kathismata are like the kelia, but usually smaller. Finally, in remote and inaccessible locations, there are hermitages, simple huts, shelters, and more often just caves in the cliffs. It is easily perceived that the way people are living in a region, as well as the available local building materials, have great influence on the architecture of that region. This effect becomes even greater if the way of life of the inhabitants is quite special compared to those found in the rest of society, just as it happens in the Holy Mountain. It is necessary to explain briefly the two different ways of monastic life we meet on Mount Athos. Today, the classic cenobitic type is applied in all 20 monasteries of Mount Athos. According to it, the life in the commune is developed within the limits of the enclosure of the monastery and is based on the common daily schedule of the monks. In the context of the cenobitic type, there are included common program of services and prayer, common dining, and distribution of various obediences and jobs. The idiorhythmic type had spread during the Ottoman rule in several monasteries. In the diurethmic type, Each monk is financially independent and responsible for himself. He has a private space not only for his personal accommodation, but also for the preparation of the daily food, with private dining room and kitchen, as well as guest rooms. Today, this type has become extinct in the monasteries, but kept on the 8 diorhythmic skittas. It becomes obvious that different types of monastic life lead to different architectural solutions. The most important of Mount Athos settlements are, without doubt, the 20 monasteries. The organization of the Athonite monastery is based on the model of the ancient fortified town. It consists of a rectangular fortified enclosure surrounding a central court in which the main church, the Catholicon, forms the center of the composition. Around it, inside the court, various chapels and other buildings are scattered where space allows. The refectory or trapeza is placed opposite Catholicon. The entrances of the two buildings are closely related, stressing the processional link. The perimeter houses communal facilities like storehouses, offices, working areas, and the monks' accommodation, as well as the guest house and the hospital. Defenses provided by making the inside of the court the main facade, avoiding outside window on lower levels and piercing the enclosure with a single strongly defended gate and passage. The fortification of the religious establishments and several isolated locations on Holy Mountain is an issue that is at first glance alien to the spiritual character of the place. However, it should be considered the fact that Athonite monasteries were constituted at very difficult times. The defensive character of the monastery enclosure is more apparent in the oldest surviving parts of precincts, such as in the western part of the southern side of the Great Lavra. In the newer parts, the improvement of security conditions is expressed with the increase of windows in number and size, the creation of closed and open balconies, and the care for more organization of the facades. Nevertheless, the main spatial characteristics of the settlement, recognized in the relationship of its major structural elements, the enclosure wall, the church, and the refectory, remain constant. This continuity of elements was connected to the prescribed daily routine of the monastic life, which didn't change for centuries. This formal model is followed to the extent the topography allows. In case where horizontal expansion is problematic, the monastery expands in height with the addition of floors, often gaining a strong visual appearance. The evolutionary process, although accepting external influences and local attitudes from the neighboring mainland, maintained its strict traditions and always aimed to achieve its own objectives. In this way, Athonite architecture never lost its appeal towards the monks and remained direct towards their way of life. It aimed to fulfill the practical and spiritual aspects in their life. In this context, the element of the accidental is to be anticipated, if not forgiven, taking its place in the architectural development of the monasteries. The most important building of the monastery of Mount Athos is without doubt the main church, the so-called Catholicon. The Catholicon stands usually where space allows, free in the middle of the court, expressing in this way the sovereign role as center of the life of the monastery. The typology of Mount Athos Catholica belongs to the so-called Athonite type of church, which is basically the composite of cruciform type, cross and square plan, with the addition of two lateral niches of the choirs. All have the basic parts of church, narthex, naos, and sanctuary. The distinctive difference from the Byzantine church elsewhere are the spacious Usually columns support narthex, the so-called lytee, and second, the chapels that are sometimes at the end of the lytee. To the west of the lytee, there is the arcade with open or closed arches in the facade, while sometimes between this and the lytee, there is another narthex, the exonarthex, which is narrower than the lytee with simpler roof. Kyriakon. The architecture of the Kyriakon, that is the central church of the Skiti, follows in general lines the features of the architecture of Catholicon. Though it is an Athonite-type church, it is less conservative in style and simpler in form. The masonry is plainer, and the proportions of the apses and the domes are heavier than in the Catholica. From the general rule should be excluded the Kyriaka, which were built after the mid-19th century in Cenobitic Skites with a foreign monastic brotherhood, for example, in Skiti of St. Andrew in Karyes, which reflect the characteristics of Eastern European church architecture of the era. The chapels are a particularly large group of buildings on Mount Athos. Sometimes they are separate buildings, and other times part of larger building complexes, Catholica, monastic wings, towers, cells, boat houses, etc. From a typological point of view, the majority of chapels belongs to a compact cross-registered type. In this type, the columns are attached to the side walls as pilasters, so that the whole space of the nave to be covered by a dome, usually without a drum. The refectory or trapeza is the most important building after the Catholicon in the monasteries of Mount Athos. The monks go there in procession after the end of divine liturgy. It is logical, therefore, that it should be located in the immediate vicinity of the Catholicon, so that the distance between the entrance to be the smallest possible. When the area of the monastery allows it, the refectory is an independent building, like in Great Lavra and Vatopedi. Otherwise, as it usually happens, the refectory is part of the wing which is the most close to the Catholicon. The interior walls of refectories are decorated with religious images, stressing the sacred character of the building. The older ones having solid built tables, and the later ones long wooden tables. The architectural shape of the building is closely related to its function. It is a long rectangular hall, usually with an apse on its shorter side. At that end, usually, is the niche with the abbot's table. The fiali is used for the ceremony of the blessing of the waters. The fiales are the most elegant architectural elements of the Athonite monasteries. These are small circular buildings covered with a mud brick hemispherical dome, which is supported through brick-built also arch by 8 marble pillars. They are usually found west of the Catholicon. Not all the monasteries have one. Where there is insufficient space, open space, there is no fiali. The buildings of the wings, intended for the installation of the monastic community, they include areas that accommodate various needs of the monastery, integrating often buildings with special functions, for example, the refectory or the kitchen, wherever there is not enough space. In these cases, the Catholica and the Fiales are the only buildings that usually remain independent. The ground floor and the basement are usually used for the storage of various supplies, food, wine, oil, etc., while the other floors are occupied by spaces of permanent residence, rooms for monks, nursing homes, hospitals, places of administrative functions, offices, συνοδικών, abbess, as well as space for the reception and the guest rooms. Depending on the needs of its specific use, there are also corresponding auxiliary spaces, kitchens, lavatories, etc., and of course, chapels. The typology and the structure of the buildings of the wings have not changed substantially through the centuries. The construction consists of two main longitudinal walls. Depending on the specific layout of the rooms, on the upper floors, the access is usually achieved either through successive galleries that occupy the side of the building towards the courtyard, or through internal corridors along the central axis. Regarding to the form of the wings, the outer facades of the oldest examples of the early Ottoman rule were solid and immutable, with a strongly fortified character, with little or no decoration, and without special care about morphology. The symmetrically placed windows of different sizes are the result of subsequent improvisations. Until the 17th century, the facades of the wings towards the courtyard are formed in successive continuous rows of wooden balconies alleged on pillars or wooden columns. By mid-century, the facades of the successive brick arches and the walls of rubble masonry with brick decoration begin to dominate. During the 18th century, the application of the galleries with arcades generalized and the brick decorative masonry got enriched. From the beginning of the 19th century, gradually the facades of the fully built arcades with the blind arches seem to prevail. In these cases, there are rows of rooms on both sides of the buildings, and instead of rubble masonry, they're used to have been built walls with same-hewn stones and bricks. After the 19th century, the use of purely same-hewn or fully chamber masonry expands and begins to show influences from the sophisticated architecture of the time, while there are some influences of classicism in individual elements of the buildings. The defensive character of the Pan-Athonite establishments makes the tower an essential element of their architecture. Built at the highest or the weakest point of the monastery, they served as observation posts against pirate raids and as the monks' last refuge when the rest of the monastery had been occupied by pirates or brigands. Observation towers were also built over a number of the monastery's boathouses. Towers are buildings of square plan, constructed with a rubble masonry. They have a staircase inside, a chapel at the top, and embrasures or machicolations all around. The walls of the lower floors are shaped for safety reasons, with no openings, but on the upper floors, there are few small openings. On the ground floor, there are water tanks and storage spaces, while on the upper floors, spaces for the accommodation of the people residing there. On the highest level, there are built narrow, closed balconies with machicolations in the floor to assist in the defense against the besiegers. These elements, in combination with the necessary battlements at the top of the walls, give the otherwise heavy and without decoration towers a sense of variety and some morphological interest. From the early days of monasticism on Mount Athos, the sea formed the primary means of communication both with the outside world as well as within the community due to the mountainous interior of the peninsula and the absence of infrastructure discouraging land travel. Each monastery possessed then, as it still does today, its own boat, which has been used for transport, fishing, and trade purposes. The importance of sea travel, as well as the need for protection against pirate raids, materialized in the buildings of boathouses or arsenals. As a result, the characteristic type of boathouse found on Athos is the defended boathouse, which combines the boat store and storage bay area with a defense tower housing the caretaker's accommodation. The boat store consists of an elongated space with a large arched entrance, which is always open at the narrow side towards the sea, so that it is easy to lift or launch the boats to and from the interior. The towers of the boathouses provide the first line of defense against pirate raids scattered on the coasts of Athos. Today, Mount Athos faces the challenge of adapting itself to modern technologies without losing its traditional character. As far as architecture is concerned, this balance is not always easy. More young monks have a renovating spirit and are bent on leading a less retiring life. As a result, just next to humble traditional cells, big and modern buildings erect in order to accommodate and serve modern needs and amenities. The authority for restoration work in Athonite architecture belongs to the Center for the Preservation of Mount Athos Heritage, KEDAC. Among the key principles of restoration is that a human work is a carrier of memory. The aim of the restorer is to safeguard the memories of human generation as they are imprinted in the passage of time over the bodies of monuments. Our everyday effort at KEDAC is to achieve a balance between tradition and the contemporary demands of modern monastic life. Thank you very much for your attention.